Europe is in the grip of a huge migration crisis. An influx of millions fleeing war and seeking new lives.
We love our country, but it's destroyed. We can't live in it.
I'm travelling to Europe's gateway, Greece, to follow the journeys of migrant children caught up in the chaos. I see the suffering of the most vulnerable.
She's got hypothermia, and actually they're worried that she might have meningitis.
I encounter young teenagers travelling thousands of miles all alone. I meet young families facing possible deportation.
The border's closed. We're stuck here.
And I witness total desperation.
Help me in the name of God, please.
Emergency. I call them.
He needs an ambulance. This is the most shocking thing I've seen so far.
The Greek island of Lesbos. The busiest landing point in Europe for hundreds of thousands of migrants. A third are under 18. I've come here to follow their journeys.
So here are just some of the life jackets that have been found in Greece. Last year, it became clear that this refugee crisis was a huge humanitarian issue. The kids are absolutely the most vulnerable throughout this whole ordeal. So I've come to Lesbos to meet the kids as soon as they enter Europe to try and find out what their journey really involves.
First stop is the port of Mytilene. Every day, thousands, mostly Syrians, Iraqis and Afghans, arrive here from Turkey. Many have been rescued by Greek coast guards from overcrowded dinghies.
I mean, I imagine some of them would have been taken from the water.
No, no.
In them smaller boats that have been often capsized.
A lot of these kids are freezing cold and soaked through. They've been stuck in the water for hours.
Talk me through your journey. What was the sea like?
كان موج عالي بس كان يدخل شوي للبلم بعدين تعبى للنص. ضلينا ثلاث ساعات بالمي حتى اجى قطر السواحل واخذنا.
The crossing has left one young girl in a critical condition.
She's got dry blood down the front of her face. She's got hypothermia, and actually they're worried that she might have meningitis. So they're just taking her to the hospital now.
I'm only here for a morning, but the boats keep coming.
It's just relentless. It's like blinking, another one comes. And since I've been here, over 1,000 people have been rescued.
I want to know what makes so many parents undertake these gruelling journeys with their kids.
So this is your boy. What's the most difficult thing you think the kids are about to witness?
Many children fleeing conflicts in Syria, Afghanistan, and Iraq don't survive the crossing. Since September, an estimated 370 children have drowned trying to get from Turkey to Greece.
So I'm now approaching this purpose-built cemetery. Initially,
when the bodies were being washed up. They were laying them to rest in the main cemetery in Mytilene, but they quickly ran out of space. So as a result, they've had to lay the bodies here. Some of them have no names. Their bodies were so battered and so decomposed that they're now unidentifiable. This here, we think, are a set of twins, unknown females, 3 months old. So they didn't even get to see their first birthday. This one here, unknown male, 3 years old. Unknown infant male, 1 year old. Again, probably brothers or certainly relatives, because they've been buried next to each other. A lot of young teenagers make the long journey alone, often sent ahead by their families, because unaccompanied children have more chance of getting asylum in Europe. Under Greek law, these kids should be taken into the care of the state.
Hey, Christina.
Hey, Stacey.
How's things? Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you as well. Welcome.
Christina runs this transit shelter. It looks after unaccompanied minors whilst the Greek government processes their cases.
So here is normally the girls' room, okay. And the room that we always keep available for vulnerable cases.
How many kids start the journey off without their parents, and how many of them lose their parents along the way?
Majority of the children have a parent either back in the country of origin or somewhere forward in Europe that we've met. There are a few cases that have lost their parents on the way, that saw them dying, that lost them in Turkey, that we had a case of a little girl that lost her parents in the shipwrecks.
How old was she?
11. Just 11 years old.
Both parents?
Both parents and three siblings.
Christina introduces me to two 14-year-old Afghan cousins who've travelled here by themselves, hoping to get to Sweden. Because they're vulnerable, we've been asked to disguise their identities.
So this picture here, what's going on?
The boys tell me about the dangers of travelling thousands of miles alone from Afghanistan. So people that fell off were just left?
عکس خود طالبا است. طالبا امیرکم بود مسلح بودن از ما پول میگرفتن. پول نمیداشتن ما را اجازه نمیداد.
What would you say is the most difficult part of travelling on your own without your parents?
شما اگر رقم اطمینان شماره خانه را یا آدرس خانه را رقم میگرفت زنگ میزد از پدر یا از فامیل پول میخواست که تا تو را ایلا کنه شکنجه هم میکرد که یک دونر من داشت افغانی دولتی خود افغانستان دیدم که دستایش تقریبا اصلا پوست و گوشش نبود که بعض گوشت از پایش گرفته.
Identifying the real ages of unaccompanied migrant children is difficult for the Greek authorities. At another temporary shelter, I discover that some are being registered as adults. Hello. Boys like 16-year-old Hasib from Afghanistan.
You told the Greek authorities that you're only 16 and you haven't got your parents with you. Really? And the Greek authorities, have they given you any paper? Can I see it? It says here, the 1st of the 1st, 1998. So that would make you 18.
بهم نگو تغییر داده. داده گوستند چند گفتن 16. دیگر کامل نوشته که ولی وقت داده الان سه کرده تو گفتی من نمیفهم.
He wants to make it to Sweden to get the education he says he can't access back home.
بچه ها مثلا بتونه مدرسه بره که برای خودشون بتونه یک کاری بشه ته. کس نمیتونه مدرسه بره چون مثلا جنگ مدرسه رو بیشتری رو آتش میده مثلا کس نمیتونه بره اونجا.
That evening, Haseeb is due to catch a ferry to Athens for the next leg of his journey. But he's lost the people he's travelling with, and he's worried about leaving without them.
Haseeb, you need to go because the last coach has left. When was the last time you saw him? I'll wait for you here. He's sort of stuck between a rock and a hard place because they're not his family. So people that are a bit more ruthless would say he should just go. All the other miners, they've got their family to make sure that they're getting a wiggle on. He hasn't got anyone. He's relying on himself. Eventually, he finds the rest of his group and heads off to catch the ferry. Down at the port, I witness how easily families can get separated in the chaos. So that's the boat now off to Athens, and that poor woman was just utterly hysterical. You know, she was shouting and pointing, and I can only assume that that's a family now split up. I follow the migrant trail to Greece's capital, Athens, the next stop on the journey to Western Europe. So this is the ferry coming in now.
But when I arrive, news comes in that the country's northern border has just been closed to all Afghans. Coach services taking migrants there have stopped, leaving thousands stranded at the port.
Sounds like an indoor playground. I'm totally overwhelmed by the sheer number of kids, toddlers.
Outside, I get talking to an Afghan father who's now unable to continue the journey with his young family.
I am Stacey.
Yeah, I'm Sayed. Nice
to meet you. Lovely to meet you, Sayed. Yeah. Three children in total.
Yeah, this one is disabled. And she's my wife, Nahid.
Lovely to meet you. Tell me what your life was like in Afghanistan for your kids.
Life was good. Life was running very well until I got beaten by unknown people. That's why you are working in the TV and why you are broadcasting our negative points. You know, about the human rights, about the woman rights.
So some locals had an issue with you talking about women's rights on television.
Yeah. Too many times I have received a warning. This was the only option. And now you're suffering this.
Of course.
Yeah.
The journey is difficult enough for one adult. You have got three small children and one of them is disabled. How on earth did you get here?
Don't ask about that because I don't want to remember it, at least. Because our car engine was damaged in the desert and we spent one night in the desert. And the Taliban caught us. But we were lucky because I got this kid. And they saw this kid and they let us go.
What was the boat crossing like?
The boat was very small, about 9 meters. But they were shifting about 18 people inside it. And they were not allowed, you're not allowed to carry a bag. I had a small bag, only for diapers and some milk for the kids. But they threw it in the sea. And one kid died. They were about to bury him today. And he was 1.5 years old. And he died. Yeah, I saw that because I had a kid. And now we are here. And the border's closed. We stuck here. I don't know what will happen next. Because everybody says that no one's gonna open the border for you guys because you're from Afghanistan. But if you suffer this condition, you will know what I'm talking about.
Thank you for talking to me. Give me 2 seconds. It's just very, very heartbreaking to hear a father who so clearly wants what's best for his family break his heart. And he articulates perfectly his dilemma. He's just so desperate. Really eloquent man. I want to know more about how the border closures are impacting Afghan children. That evening, I find dozens of families sleeping rough in a square because the shelters in the city are full. It feels like so many people here tonight are from Afghanistan.
Yes, all of them, I think all the people you see here around, they're all from Afghanistan. We Afghans really feel hopeless here, you know.
Will you stay on the streets as well tonight?
I have nowhere to go, nowhere else to go. I'm not worried about myself, you know. There's a lot of families, little children.
They must just be thinking, where the hell am I? I'm introduced to 10-year-old Samila and her 2-year-old brother. Where are you sleeping, your family, this evening?
She's going to ask.
So this is where these guys plan to spend the night, under a tree, because it's their only form of shelter. The next day, I discover just how desperate the situation has become for some. So I don't know if you can see this guy just being taken away now. But apparently he was very depressed, very distressed.
He's from Pakistan and he's trying to suicide.
And he tried to commit suicide. Just him, two people.
They're from Pakistan.
He's trying to resuscitate him. This is the most shocking thing I've seen so far. They need to call an ambulance. Everyone's looking, but they're not ringing. He needs an ambulance. An ambulance.
Yes, my friend. Yeah,
call for ambulance.
45 minutes later, and still no sign of medical help.
I called them.
What did they say?
Please help me, please.
I said,
help me in the name of God, please.
Emergency. I called them.
Where's this ambulance? You called the ambulance again?
They called the ambulance again. They're in the way. I don't know when.
I'm so sorry. I don't know what else to say. We've called it so many times. Finally, paramedics arrive. You know, this is happening in broad daylight in the middle of a European country. I don't know what else we need to see for something to drastically change. You know, kids are being pulled out of the sea. People are trying to hang themselves in the middle of a square. These are still people, you know what I mean? They have limits. It's just very, very sad. It's very sad. The two men survived, but with nowhere to go, they returned to the square the next day. I
I leave Athens and follow the trail north towards the border used by migrants to exit Greece. Because of overcrowding at the crossing, Greek police have stopped all coaches from travelling there. As a result, camps have now sprung up on the side of the road. So I was en route to the Macedonian border, just stumbled across this. Can we stop here? Is that okay? Thank you. I wouldn't mind just popping out. I want to speak. Look at this. It's people sleeping in the belly of the coach where you're meant to put your luggage. Hello. How are you? Where have you been sleeping? Been sleeping on the bus? And why are you here? Why are you having to sleep on the bus? Show me where you're sleeping. Oh, okay, so on the corridor, not actually on the chairs. So the smaller babies are sleeping this way. Wow. Thank you. After being stuck here for 2 days, this group of Syrians decide there's only one thing for it.
Yalla! Baba!
Where are you guys going?
To the border.
You're going to start the walk? So even these babies?
Even this.
How will the babies manage?
We will take care of them.
The border is 15 miles away, a big ask for the kids. But the group push on, worried the border will soon close to all migrants. It's heavy that. Will I carry it for a minute? I leave the Syrian group to continue with their journey. I make my own way to the main camp at the crossing point. So this is us just coming into Idomeni camp now, right on the border with Macedonia. It's immediately obvious that this place is wildly overcrowded and supplies are running low.
For now, we have only this.
So that lady is after a tent for her family. She has a small child. But the only thing they can offer her is two blankets. There just aren't any left. Hello? You okay? A Syrian teenager travelling alone tells me he's preparing to sleep rough. You didn't manage to get yourself a tent? How long do you expect to have to stay here? Where are your parents?
Mama Syria. بعد سوريا ما فينا نرجع يعني إنه ضرب البيت هذا بعد صاروخ نحن كنا بالبيت الساعة 12 بالليل نزل صاروخ فراغي يعني نزلت البناء اللي ورانا وبيتنا من ورا نقص وما حسينا يعني فقنا وقت ضرب فقنا كله أبيض.
Tell me what the most difficult part of all of this is as a 15-year-old on his own.
ما هلا هون ولا شيء يعني ما لي خايف أبدا. يعني بسوريا تعديت الخوف خلاص ما ضل في خوف خلاص.
Because of the volume of people crossing European borders, this one has just been closed to all migrants. A Syrian girl tells me there will be a protest if it's not reopened. So where are you sleeping at the minute?
We have slept 3 days in the street. Yeah, we don't have, like, we had 4 blankets, we are 11, now we freeze. If the situation is still like this, we really want to make a strike. We won't eat, we won't do anything, just like, we will just stand there to let us pass the borders, please.
I can imagine it's massively frustrating because It's the not knowing, mm-hmm. I think, what is so difficult.
Yeah, it's so difficult. And if the war will end in Syria, we will come back. Don't worry, we will not just stay there. We love our country, but it's destroyed. We can't live in it. It's not your problem. We just want to live.
The longer I'm here, the more I sense that frustrations are ready to boil over.
Don't fight.
You go this way. You get the feeling that everyone here agrees that this just isn't sustainable. Inside one of the tents, people are hungry and increasingly frantic.
هلا في حرب بسوريا معقولة نحن قاطعين بالبحر هذا الولد وعندي ثلاث اولاد ثانيين قاطعين نحن بالبحر كلياتنا مشان نجي نقعد هون بالخيام هاي الاولاد صار لها شهر ما بتعرف النوم هذا الولد والله صار له شهر ما تحمم
Then one man issues the call for a protest
اسمعوني دقيقتي بكره الساعة 11 اذا ما بعد 2000 شخص رح نروح نقعد على البوابة اسمعيني يا اخي
It was electrifying. You know, this lad jumped on his pal's shoulders and said, that's it, I'm going to head a peaceful protest. This isn't about fighting, this isn't about kicking off. We're going to go towards the border, sit down calmly, no blankets, some of us will be on hunger strike. We need to show them that we mean business, we want to cross this border. That night, a few miles away from the camp, things turn violent. Locals burn down these disused army barracks, angry at plans to house migrants here. The next day, I head there. A teacher tells me the incident isn't reflective of the local population. Do you know what happened? Saturday and Sunday, there were two barracks burnt down.
No, it's not a big subject.
Well, it is, because it happened.
The people here are peaceful and friendly.
Most of them maybe, but
not
some
most.
Of them not, because All they them. Set a building on fire.
We've got about one man who have a different opinion, so it's not for us, from us.
Yeah,
the majority of people.
Yeah, I'm not suggesting it was you or the majority.
I'm sure for that.
But the minority, are angry, and they're angry enough to go around setting things on fire.
No, we talk about one man, silly boy.
But he does say many Greeks are very concerned about the huge influx of migrants on their doorstep.
We have our problems. Now we have another problem with 1,000 people. Mm-hmm. We are ready to help them, but we cannot afford 1,000 of 10,000 of 100,000 people.
So emotionally, would love to be able to help. You sympathize, but actually realistically, financially, you're not in a position to do so.
There are Greek families that cannot feed their children. You have to understand that Greek people are poor.
After 2 weeks following children on the migrant trail through Greece, it's time to head home. At Idomeni camp, the migrants carry out their protest. But the border remains closed. A group tries to break down the fence. Macedonian police fire tear gas. The The European Union has since taken action to severely limit the number of migrants arriving in Greece. And thousands of migrant children already in the country will now not be allowed into Western Europe. For them, that spells even more upheaval, more uncertainty, and more suffering.